Hello, everyone, and inside today's Locked On Canadiens, a bit of a Saturday night snoozer, and we're going to grade the Canadiens trade deadline.
You are Locked On Canadiens, your daily podcast on the Montreal Canadiens, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 1027 of Locked On Canadiens, your daily Montreal Canadiens podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, where you get your team every single day of the week. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code Locked On for $20 off your first purchase at Game Time. We are, of course, free and available wherever you get your daily podcasts on Google, Apple, Spotify, or if you are watching on YouTube.com in video as well. I am one of your hosts. I am Scott Metlin. As always, I am joined by the active stick, Laura Saba, and it is the Sunday after the NHL trade deadline. I know we did a live show and everything on Friday, but for those who might have missed it, today's show,
it's available.
It's available wherever you listen to your daily podcast and on YouTube with good friend Ian Boisvert of the Build Podcast. We're going to talk about this weekend's game against Toronto. We're going to talk about the trade deadline. We're going to talk about storylines, but I have been talking for a minute here. Laura, how are we feeling coming out of a relatively quiet Habs and Leafs game on Saturday night?
Well, that was the thing, is that it was surprising in that it didn't turn into an entire circus. The score was pretty close, which is interesting because, you know, sometimes there are blowouts between these two teams or something, you know, spectacular, like it was 4-1 and then like the Leafs trip all over themselves and allow the Canadiens to get back into the game, or, you know, the Habs get shellacked or whatever it is. This time around, it felt relatively as if it was coming back to normal. I would have wanted the Canadiens to win that game, but I feel like Nick Suzuki did everything he possibly could.
Yeah, this is a game that it ended 3-2. Toronto won off a goal that basically hit John Tavares standing at the side of the net and went in. There were some dubious officiating moments, including TJ Brody tomahawk chopping Joel Armia stick in half while the Canadiens were on a 6-on-4 power play and not getting called for it, because as we know, the refs are just against Toronto. And this overall isn't about officiating. The Canadiens did a really good job in this game neutralizing pretty much all of Toronto's major weapons. Tavares scored a goal because it hit him. Like, William Nylander, non-factor. Austin Matthews, complete non-factor. Morgan Riley was terrible for the most part. Goals in this game were scored by Max Domi, Bobby McMahon, and like I said, Tavares getting hit by a puck. Laura, I'm glad you mentioned Nick Suzuki, because he is the biggest thing. And Arpin Basu put out a tweet about this, is that the Canadiens lost, but Nick Suzuki basically pocketed Austin Matthews for an entire game, like went out there and just dominated the ice, in that he didn't get a ton of points. I think I want to say he might have gotten an assist on the second goal, but Suzuki wasn't the focal point of this game for all the things that appear on the score sheet. It was all the things that he does that don't appear on the score sheet. He in the first line, we've talked a lot about how sometimes they get beat up, and when they get beat up, things go really badly for the Canadiens here. You know, it was a close fought battle, and before anyone starts screaming in the comments, yes, I know that they didn't have Mitch Marner, but if Mitch Marner being out of the lineup makes the Leafs look that mediocre, you have a tremendous problem. Nick Suzuki got 11 minutes and 18 seconds of Austin Matthews at 5-on-5. He had an expected goals for percentage of 77%, 8 scoring chances, a 68% Corsi for. Just, he was so much better than Matthews in that game. And yes, Austin Matthews is going to score 70 goals. We're talking in a window here. And I think that's the biggest thing, is Nick Suzuki looked great. And honestly, Mike Matheson's having the best offensive season for a Habs defenseman since PK Subban was here.
And which is funny because we've been criticizing him all season for being, you know, old and tired, but he has like a newfound aspect to his game. The thing about Nick Suzuki, all right, like you said, it was a small window, but that's the thing, is that when you are a team that eventually will make the playoffs and you're one of the cornerstones of that team, this is going to be night in and night out. Like when you make the playoffs, like you are going to be matched against teams that have this elite lineup, right? That have that sometimes are so much better than you. And so what do? Is that you take the players that you have and the skills that you have at your disposal, and you exploit weaknesses and mistakes. And for whatever reason, like Austin Matthews didn't seem to want to play, right? And so Nick Suzuki was just all over him. And I guess he didn't allow him that ability to kind of spring back into action, is the way that I saw the game. And that's how I perceived Nick Suzuki's actions to be. And that's what's going to happen every single time. Like whenever we've watched the Canadiens, you know, that playoff run, or like when they beat the Caps and then they beat the Penguins and all of that kind of stuff. Like when your team is the inferior team, you have to do that. And so the intelligence is being built there, and Nick Suzuki is making me confident about the future, is that when they do start contending, when you are in those one-on-one matchups, when you are in those short matchups with these teams that you're going to have to beat and overcome that might be better than you, Nick Suzuki knows what to do and how to do it effectively.
He was quietly dominant. And that's the thing, is he does that so often that it is just, oh, Nick Suzuki went out there and just casually won. I'm actually looking up the stats behind here. I'm looking at the box score right now that, let's see, like Nick Suzuki went 70% in the faceoff dot. No points, but two shots on goal, almost 25 minutes of 5-on-5 ice time. Like he did all the quiet things. And we've talked about how good Nick Suzuki can be. He's quiet. And I want to shout out to someone who was, I don't, loud is maybe the wrong word in this, but I think it's the right one, is, Juraj Slafkovsky had two assists in that game. He said his heads up play allowed Mike Matheson to score the first goal of the game, 38 seconds in. And then he set up Alex Newhook again on the power play to tie the game on the power play later on in the game. 21 and a half minutes of ice time again, three shots on goal, two assists plus one. And just looked, he also played on that line against, you know, William Nylander and Austin Matthews. It's not an easy assignment, and came out positive against him in all the underlying metrics there. Caulfield is a part of that as well. Mike Matheson finishes with a goal and an assist. The Habs lost. They lost in regulation, so no extra points, which is always great. We love that in a season where we want the Canadiens now to play well but lose. If you are the Toronto Maple Leafs and this is how you looked, though, I have a lot of questions about your team. Joel Edmondson looked dreadful, slow, unable to keep up. He got run over by Juraj Slafkovsky. Connor Dewar was the penalty killer on the ice when Alex Newhook took the feed from Slafkovsky. TJ Brody is boxing out one side of the net. And I watched Connor Dewar drop down with his stick, you know, at his side. I realize it's hard to do this on a video thing, and drop down like he's trying to block a pass, and just gave him the entire net to shoot at. What Toronto went out and got a bunch of dudes who do not help them in any way, shape, or form. The good news in this game is Ryan Reeves didn't get to do anything stupid. He got run over by Jaden Struble at one point in this game. Sportsnet did not show me a replay of that. There wasn't a whole lot of stupid nonsense in this game. If you're going to lose a game, I prefer you lose like this, where your opponent played worse than you do, got a kind of lucky goal to win this game, and you didn't get any points. I believe the Habs are sitting seventh in the Tankathon standings right now. Yes. Let me go to the draft order.
Yeah, so just on that last point that you made, Scott, like we were talking about Toronto, like might have actively gotten worse, actually.
There was a whole thing about Simon Benoit that I was not expecting, that apparently he's actually their best defensive defenseman. Toronto's defensive group, and I'm going to say this because I didn't say it on Twitter because I feel like my mentions too much, might be worse than the Canadiens.
Wow.
He's probably better than most players on the Canadiens. Overall, I look at Toronto's core and I go, no one in this group is at the top of their game anymore.
Wow.
That is Simon Benoit. And he's a bottom pairing defenseman right now.
Yeah. Like, if that's your best defenseman, honestly, you've got problems.
Maybe I'm just being a hater. I don't know. But either way, the Habs are 1 point out of sixth. Arizona and the Habs have played the same amount of games. Arizona has 57. Ottawa hilariously lost to the Sharks last night. They have 54 points.
I don't think Ottawa has won a game against the Western Conference yet.
And they have two games left. They haven't won a game against the Western Conference this year. And one of them is Minnesota, and one of them, I believe, is Edmonton. Ian Mendez had a tweet about that. But Ottawa has two games in hand and is 4 points ahead of the Habs. Columbus has the same amount of games played. They are 4 points ahead of the Habs. Top four is very much still in play for the Canadiens. Speaking of which, Friday was the NHL trade deadline. Yes, we had a live show, but guess what? We are going to talk about grading it because everybody loves grades. And we're going to talk about some of the back half storylines, and that's all coming up next. But first, if you were like me, you know that trying to buy tickets for events can be just a frustrating headache chore. For just to go to something you want to enjoy, whether that be a Broadway play, whether that be a musical, a comedy show, a hockey game for your favorite lottery team, baseball season's right around the corner. Take all of that away. No more hidden fees. No more guessing what your seat looks like, because with Game Time, all of that is in one place and they make it super easy with things like last minute ticket deals, flash deals, zone deals. You can get views from your seats and a lowest price guarantee. There will be event cancellation protection that maybe the weather's bad. Maybe something happens. Who knows? They have it all in one place. And the best part is that your price that you see on Game Time is the price you're paying. No more hidden fees. The price you see is the price you will pay. So take all the guesswork out of buying tickets today with Game Time. Just download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code LOCKEDON for $20 off your first purchase. Some terms will apply, but again, create an account and redeem code LOCKEDON for $20 off. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. We are back here at Locked On Canadiens. Of course, we are your daily Montreal Canadiens podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. And well, the trade deadline has come to pass, which means we have to find new things to clickbait about on YouTube. If any of my bosses are listening to this, I'm kidding. I promise you, but only just a little bit.
We don't clickbait. We do analysis.
People in my Twitter mentions sometimes disagree based on the words they've used to describe it. But we're not talking about how terrible my mentions are. The trade deadline was Friday, which, by the way, was great because I did all my work early in the morning. It was 65 degrees and I got to cover the end of the trade deadline sitting on a patio at an account with my laptop watching the end of it. If you were not the San Jose Sharks or New Jersey Devils, it was a pretty fun trade deadline. We'll talk about other teams potentially later on this week, but we wanted to keep this one Habs focused, and it was, as someone in our Slack chat put it, like playing the West Coast offense. Nothing fancy, 4 yards per catch, 4 yards per carry on every play to get the first down. Kent Hughes made, I think it was 3 total moves, if we're counting back a little bit on this. Sean Monahan for a first round pick.
Jan Meshack
for Jacob Perreault. And Jake Allen for a conditional third that can become a second round pick based on the deals. And we've talked about the Monahan trade to death, but honestly, getting a first to take on that contract, not getting to trade him in the first year because he got hurt, managing to convince him to re-sign for another year, and then having him play well, stay healthy, and flipping him for another first round pick is just, it's hard to not call that A plus material. In that, I understand that maybe we wanted a prospect or something else, but getting another first round pick for a guy that was jettisoned for a first round pick is just really smart. Just really good asset management in my eyes.
Right. And this is the thing, like at this point, the Canadiens have a lot of picks in the next 2 to 3 drafts. They have been stockpiling that at the very least. So yes, it would be nice to get a prospect because we want to see the Canadians move in a direction where the players are playing together, they're developing together, they're becoming a core, they're going to contend. We want to see that, but they're like, the truth is they're not done rebuilding. Like we've seen this season, like they still have a long way to go. And those picks could always become a prospect at a later date, right? So it really, like, if you're looking at how many picks the Canadians have, it's not Arizona level, right? But it's definitely better than the Torontos, even the Detroits. Like, there are a lot of teams where you're like, what are you doing? Like, why are you trading away these picks? The Canadians are not doing that. They literally are not.
And they have, I believe it is 12 picks in the upcoming draft. They have the second most behind the Arizona Coyotes, which is always, you know, kind of what you want to see. They have 2 first round picks in this draft. They have a second round pick, 2 in the third, 1 in the fourth, 2 in the fifth, 1 in the sixth, 3 in the seventh. And then next year they have 2 firsts, 2 seconds, 3 thirds, 2 fourths, a fifth, a sixth, a seventh. And then they have all their original picks in 2026. Kent Hughes hasn't started trading out that far yet. A prospect would have been nice, but at the same time, if they didn't want to part with that, still getting a first, I understand that asset management here. We talked about Jan Mišek for Jacob Perreault in that you're swapping a higher floor for a potentially higher ceiling. Perreault had a pretty decent debut with the Rocket on Saturday. We will... If you were expecting 3 up and 3 down in this episode, we're going to be getting that in tomorrow's episode just because we had the trade deadline and games and everything to get to. We will talk about the Rocket and some of their players in that as well. Overall, like it's a trade that we will see what happens. It's beans for beans that it is what it is. Like there's not much to grade on that. The big one is Jake Allen. I don't want to say at the 11th hour, but like the 9th and a half hour, like went to New Jersey, who had a very, very confusing trade deadline. And listen to our live show if you want to hear us try and figure out what they are doing there. But New Jersey, who was desperately in need of goaltending 2.5-3 months ago, finally addressed it after firing their coach recently. And my thought is, I don't understand it, but the Canadians got a 3rd-round pick for Jake Allen that could become a 2nd-round pick if Allen plays 40 games next season, 24-25, and the team he is on makes the playoffs. So Jake Allen could start with the Devils, and let's say they do end up going for Linus Ullmark or Jacob Markstrom or something in free agency or offseason trade or whatever. If Allen gets traded for whatever reason and that team he is on makes the playoffs, the Canadians will get a 2nd-round pick out of it. The fact that Hughes got anything above like a 4th or 5th-round pick for the poor season that Jake Allen has had, it's not fancy. It's not, I would have liked a prospect in here too, because God knows the Rocket could use extra bodies, but draft picks are draft picks. And that being able to become potentially a 2nd-round pick, especially next year, if the Devils are still struggling and they will probably annoyingly rebound, which is frustrating, but it's just good asset management. The big part of this is the Canadians retained half of Allen's salary to make this trade work. They are full on retention slots until July 1st when Joel Edmondson's contract comes off the book. Then they will have Allen and Petrie's and an open spot to potentially facilitate a David Savard or, knock on wood, Josh Anderson trade or third party broker or whatnot. But I know Hughes likes having his flexibility and having a spot like that open. So it's a fine trade. I'm glad the 3-goalie carousel is done above all else right now.
And that will be something I bring up in the next segment for our second half storylines. But I think the big thing is, you know, earlier this season, we were talking about, you know, get rid of one of the goalies, whether it's going to be for a 4th-round or a 5th-round pick, like just do it, just, you know, basically get off the pot, you know, Kent Hughes. It was a very confusing time for us in Montreal. And like, note that in none of those scenarios did we ever think a 3rd-rounder was possible, let alone one that could become a 2nd-rounder.
Yeah. And I think that's the thing, is that it's like, if Allen played like he had in previous years and he's over a 900 or something like that, then maybe it's something different. However, you know, he was not. Edmondson's salary comes off. Petrie and Allen's will both come off after next season too, freeing that up. Carl Alsner's buyout also stops this offseason, so that's another $833,000 coming off the books. There's some deals that I don't think players are going to be coming back, just kind of looking in here. Tanner Pearson's contract will be off the books. For the most part, though, the Habs are in, I think, a pretty good spot with the cap rising and the pieces that they do have. Overall, I'm calling the trade deadline like a solid B for the Canadiens. I would have liked to have seen maybe Tanner Pearson moves. Maybe they give Jesse Olenin or Michael Pezzetta a fresh start. They need a fourth line center, but Colin White should be back this week overall for that. We also forgot to mention they papered Jaden Struble and Joshua Wada-Laval. They called them both back up. They will be eligible if the Rocket make the postseason playoffs as well, which, after this weekend looks a little bit better, but that will be part of our discussion today and tomorrow's show as well. Laura, what is your passing grade for the Canadiens trade deadline here?
I was going to give them a C, which was, you know, a pass. But after talking about it with you guys on the live show and going over it and thinking like the Canadiens actually did a lot better than they could have done. So I think, you know, you're not way off with a B. Like I would give them a B as well. But, you know, I did start with a barely passing grade.
Yeah. Sound off in the comments. We know some people wanted much more, which is understandable, but sometimes you work with the hand that you are dealt on that. And sometimes you just go, well, we're just going to let this guy go in the off season. We do want to talk about back half storylines here in Montreal, and that's going to be coming up next. But first, today's show is also brought to you by the folks at FanDuel. Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every single game in the tournament. Whether you're betting on the big upset or the favorite one seed, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook. And right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. So if you're putting money on that, you know, four seed, you know, getting upset like happens every year, or the miracle run of number 16 to the Sweet 16 Elite Eight, you can do that all on FanDuel. And that's $200 to use on point spreads, money lines. You can even pick who you think is going to win it all on an app that is safe, secure, and super easy to use. And when you hit big, you can cash out immediately and go spend your earnings on some hard-earned cold ones there. Just visit FanDuel.com/lockedon and bet on college hoops until they start cutting down the nets. We are back here at Locked On Canadiens. We are wrapping up the show here. Normally, we would do three up and three down on Monday, but like I said, we had a trade deadline, we had a game, and then just a lot of things to focus on, and we wanted to talk about. I know that the graphic on the side here says second half storylines. It is really a tale of three seasons. It is the first half, it is the first third, the third to the trade deadline, then the final third to the draft lottery here, if you were the Montreal Canadiens. And for me, I look at this as, what are the biggest storylines in the second half? And we talked about it in the first segment in the Toronto game. Suzuki, Caulfield, Slafkovsky. What can we get? What is their next level? Slafkovsky at 20 assists on the season. Cole Caulfield is one shy of his previous career total of assists. He had 32 in his first 132 NHL games. He has 31 assists this season alone. And Nick Suzuki is trending towards a career year. We've talked about them ad nauseum, but I think that's where everyone's eyes are going to be. But also, I'm interested to see, what can Alex Newhook do? He's playing center, and he's doing about as well as he can in that role alongside Joshua and Joel Armia. Can the maligned vets find something that makes them valuable this offseason? Joel Armia continues to play really solid two-way hockey, not a ton of points, but doing all the things that coaches love. Josh Anderson, we didn't mention this against Toronto, was everywhere. He did everything except score a goal again. He came close, but can some of these maligned vets kind of get any semblance of like a happy ending to the year here? The Habs can lose, but if Josh Anderson goes on a goal scoring run and makes himself seem valuable, awesome. Great. Same for Brendan Gallagher. It's just, you know, is there any hope of finding their game the back half of this season is probably the biggest thing I can imagine right now.
And for me, that was one of the big things was, I mean, we talked about the grades in the previous segment, but the Canadiens are a team, or one of the few teams, whose future didn't get actively worse. You know, for those who are going for it and mortgaging their picks, like they're, you know, they better win or at least come close, because they're getting rid of their draft capital while they're doing that. The Canadiens are not there. They're also not being fleeced on trades, which we saw a few times in this offseason. They're not getting rid of a star for no reason and then putting in two third rounders. Like, they did not get actively worse, right? So now the question becomes, how do they keep trending for the better? I think we can all agree that the vets that you just mentioned, like, some of them need to get better and some of them need to get off the books as soon as possible. So whatever happens, like, we're hoping for much improvement over the course of the next couple of months. Whatever it is. All right. I have forgotten how to talk. It is Sunday, and full disclosure, I have had 0 hours of sleep, so this is why I am
This is because daylight savings time is a scam, and it's awful and terrible. So, like,
I wish that was my reason, but yes,
just sorry. Use it as your reason. You don't have to lie. Just say that that's the reason. It's fine. Everyone would believe you. Spring daylight savings is nonsense and terrible, and everybody hates it. So, the other big storyline is prospects. This is prospect season for everybody who pretended to pay attention to prospects all year. This is when everyone becomes a prospect expert, is that you have Owen Beck, who as of the time of this recording is on a 14 game scoring streak or point streak. With terrible hair. Not that I can say anything, like, I'm having a midlife crisis mullet happen here right now. He's dominating the OHL. You have Lane Hutson and BU looking to make a deep run in the NCAA tournament. You have BC and Jacob Fowler, who's one of the top goalies in the country, trying to go deep in that tournament. You have some of the other guys in other leagues. Like, I look at Rhett Pitlick, who's playing at a point per game at Minnesota. He's a junior. If Minnesota gets eliminated, is he coming to the Rocket? Are they going to convince him on an AHL deal? Engstrom and Reinbacher, you know, their seasons aren't over yet, but they could be soon, depending on their final games of the year. When will they be making their appearance here, coming over from Europe? It's like the Jesse Ylönen watch thing from a couple of years ago, only COVID hopefully doesn't shut down the country this time. Bogdan Konyushkov's out of the playoffs. He is not coming over at this point. There's no transfer agreement. He has a three-year contract in the KHL. There is a almost 0% chance anything happens there. But the Rocket had a great weekend. You have all these prospects here. The second half storyline is, what does the future look like for me? Can we get the vets back on track and Slafkovsky looking good? What is Philip Machard doing? What are the guys in the AHL doing? When are the other prospects who are able to come over and who are coming here? The Habs might be playing some really terrible, unwatchable hockey, like, full disclosure, in the next couple weeks here, but there's still so much else to tune in and watch. OHL teams are clinching playoff spots. The Frozen Four and conference tournaments are right around the corner. You have the SHL and Liga playoffs. You have the NLA relegation playoffs for Reinbacher. There's so much happening that you do not have to just watch the Habs lose. You can go and watch the future pieces of this team, you know, push for playoff berth, push to win championships. We know Owen Beck's going to be playing in the Memorial Cup because Saginaw is hosting it, but that doesn't mean there's not other people that you can tune in, that you shouldn't tune in and watch as well. Pay attention to that. We're going to have prospect people on. We're going to have draft people on. As soon as we get down to that final nitty gritty, it is switching gears. We are all prospects. We are all draft heavy and everything, but I think those are my biggest second half storylines. Laura, I'm not sure if you had a different thought.
I have one, and it affects both the Laval Rocket and the Habs. So the Canadians decided to go with Caden Primo. And the question is, how does he do now under the pressure? Now that they've selected him as the backup, effectively, they're like, this is your thing now. And two, now they don't have anyone, so they can't lend him to Laval.
Well, Kazimir Keskisuo came back from injury this weekend. He got a win. Jakub Dobish is still the starter there. I am very curious kind of what, because like I said, if someone else does get hurt, oh boy. Then we start having a fun, happy, not so happy fun time there. But
Right. And in the last couple of, like, you know, when they made the playoffs or when they went deep in the playoffs, like, Caden Primo was such a central part of that. And now they have to do it with someone else, and he has to do it in a different league. So I'm just interested to see how his starts go from here on out until the end of the season and how Laval fares.
And I think that's it. I haven't looked at the Habs schedule yet. Like, I want to see kind of.
It's a tough schedule. So it's going to be some tough starts.
Well, they have the Blue Jackets on Tuesday. I would potentially give Primo that. You have the Bruins on Thursday, the Flames on Saturday, the Oilers on Tuesday, Canucks, Kraken, Avs, Fly. Like, I'm trying to look down here. I'm like, Primo's not going to get, like, a lot of easy starts in here, but you're the backup now. Like, I know this is not like a three-tier thing where it's like Primo gets clearly, like, the poorer teams or they're scheduling a loss, so to speak. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 games left. If Primo starts six of those, I think that's a pretty good – that's, you know, a third of the games left.
Yeah.
I think that's a good balance between giving Montembeau his starts and giving him his reps and giving Primo the opportunity.
Yes.
And if here's the thing is, if Primo nails it, great. You have a really dirt cheap backup goalie next year, and you cannot rush someone else coming into the AHL. Let Dobish cook for another year and give him that time. Yes. As always, we do want to hear from you, our listeners. What are you looking for in the second half of this season here? Which prospect are you most keeping the eye on? What storylines are you paying attention to? Tweet us at @LO_Canadiens on Twitter, lockdowncanadiens@gmail.com. We will be back. We have a game preview. We have 3 up and 3 down coming tomorrow. We just couldn't fit it in with all the other news going on. Follow Laura at The Active Stick. Follow myself at Scott Matla. Subscribe to Locked On Sports Today if you want a 24/7 sports stream on youtube.com. And as always, folks, we will see you all next time.